गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वी वेलकम यू टू ऑर्थो टीवी ओरिजिनल वेबिनार सीरीज। टुडे वी हैव अ फुट एंड एंकल स्पेशलिस्ट डॉक्टर अभिषेक किनी। ही हैज डन हिज फेलोशिप फ्रॉम जर्मनी एंड हॉलैंड एंड यूके इन फुट एंड एंकल। ही इज गोइंग टू टॉक टू अस ऑन पेन इन द हील एंड हिज मैनेजमेंट ऑप्शंस। दिस वेबिनार हैज बीन ब्रॉट टू यू बाय एन अनरिस्ट्रिक्टेड एजुकेशनल ग्रांट from GSK Consumer, the makers of Iodex Ultra Gel. So over to Dr. Abhishek.
Yeah, hi, thank you Neeraj and Ortho TV for having me here. I think in today's talk, what we are going to try and talk to you about is a very common condition that we all see, and it's called in our OPD, that's pain in the heel or heel pain that patient comes to us. So we're going to talk about management options. And we'll see at the end of the talk, I hope we can get home certain points that will help you in your practice and treat these large number of patients that come to us in a little better way. So we all know that we have evolved from four-legged animal to a two-legged social animal. And that's why the function of the foot has evolved from flexible primate appendage, which was used to hold on to twigs and branches, to stability, which is now more calf dependent and is important for us to balance. Now, this has changed the role of a foot drastically from what it used to be in our original primate. And hence, in our urban lifestyle, we have also seen the footwear evolved from Ram Rajya, where there used to be Padukas, to this current generation Ram Leelas, where we wear Oxford shoes and stilettos. This urban lifestyle change has brought us a very common condition, that is heel pain. So we know that heel pain is very common in the society. We see a lot of these heel pain patients in our day-to-day OPD. And there is a lot of commonly misdiagnosed condition for heel pain, like not all are A or B, which we'll try to clarify in this talk. And there is a lot of misinformation about this heel pain also, which we would like to clarify at the end of this talk. So basically, heel pain is divided broadly into two categories. One is infracalcaneal, that is below the heel, and one is retrocalcaneal, which is behind the heel. These two categories are completely different animals in their own right, and they have to be divided and identified properly so that you can come to their diagnosis and management. Infracalcaneal can be various things, like most common is plantar fasciitis. Then there can also be heel pad atrophy, calcaneal stress fractures, plantar nerve impingements, and other inflammatory arthropathies. While retrocalcaneal is less common but more satisfying to treat, there is the Hägglund syndrome, Achilles insertional tendinosis, and a retrocalcaneal bursitis. So most common patient comes to us with an X-ray which is like this, and we all, like most of us, tell them that, you know, aapka haddi bada hua hai. But I would like to take this opportunity to point it out to you all that this is not pathological. In fact, it is common in 50% of individuals, even 15% normal individuals have it. It is not pathological. It is at the origin of flexor hallucis brevis. So if you look at the heel from here, it is more laterally that the spur is on the lateral border of the calcaneum, and the plantar fascia originates more on the medial side. So on the two-dimensional X-ray, you will see the spur, but it is not pathologic. The pathology is more medial than lateral. Imagine if you had a heel or if you had a nail in your shoe, every step should have been painful. But these spurs are not painful at every step. It's not like that it's the head of the turtle that goes in when you try to put steps after a few times, right? It is always there and it's not always painful. So it is not pathologic. The pain is at medial side, which is at the plantar fascia origin, and this spur is a traction enthesophyte at the origin of flexor digitorum brevis, which is more lateral. Okay, sir? So just to brief the anatomy, so plantar aponeurosis has three segments: medial, which covers the abductor hallucis, lateral, which covers the abductor digiti quinti, and the central fascia, which is more pathologic, originates from the medial calcaneal tuberosity and extends to the plantar plate of the proximal phalanges. This central fascia is which is most painful and most pathologic in most people. So coming to the infracalcaneal group of heel pain, most common condition is plantar fasciitis. It is due to irritation of proximal plantar fascia, as we just described in the anatomy. It is associated with gastrocnemius and hamstring tightness. So there are phylogenetic origins of plantar fascia from the Achilles tendon. And hence, Achilles tendon tightness also predisposes us to plantar fascia tightness, which causes this pain when you acutely stretch. So what does the patient come with? It comes with when the patient is sleeping or sitting and the patient rises to without stretching these tendon structures. A forced dorsiflexion of standing causes an acute stretch and this is painful. So a corollary to understand this, if your sleeve is too tight and if you stretch it, most commonly it will tear at where it has been stitched, either at the ends of your sleeves at the shoulder or where your cuffs are attached. So something similar, without stretching, a tight plantar fascia or a tight Achilles tendon would cause it to stretch beyond its flexibility and cause tear or micro tears, which causes inflammation and pain. On examination, you will have a tender proximal plantar fascia, which is the medial calcaneal tuberosity. If you do a passive dorsiflexion of the great toe, it kind of enhances the windlass mechanism of your plantar fascia and causes pain at the plantar fascia origin. So this is a test to kind of confirm that plantar fascia is the pathologic point. If you do a heel squeeze, as shown in the picture on the right, it will be negative because heel squeeze elicits tenderness from the bone, which is more commonly seen in a calcaneal stress fracture, which I'll cover up later. So heel squeeze is negative, plantar fascia origin is tender and symptomatic. So how do you treat plantar fascia? It is also called as the low back ache of foot and ankle, which kind of sometimes improves with time. Acute phase needs anti-inflammatory medicines. You can try soft insoles, offloading orthotics, but stretching is the crux of treatment. Stretching should be followed with military discipline, or in our country, you have to tell them in a religious discipline. So there are two regimes. There are two regimes that are there to follow. One is a passive plantar foot stretching program, which actually is stretching. You need to do 10 repetitions of 3 sets, followed by 3 times in a day for 3 months. It is 10 by 3 by 3. And this is more regular. It needs more patient motivation and follow-up to do it. The other program is a high load strength training, which is an alternate day program, which can also be tried. Both these programs at the end of 3 months have shown to reduce pain and sensitivity by almost 80%. So this is the first line of treatment. How do you do a program? It's very simple. You need to stretch regularly and make sure that you form, sometimes write a pain diary, so that yes, it's kind of school mechanism where you try to teach them to do it every day. Second line, you can try some night splints or a Strasbourg sock, as shown in the picture on the right. It kind of stretches the whole plantar fascia and Achilles while you sleep. And so at the end, also when you begin your day in the morning, there is no tightness and it doesn't cause pain, but it's extremely cumbersome to wear these socks at night. Next line of treatment is extracorporeal shockwave therapy. They say it stimulates angiogenesis, disrupts the calcific deposits and increase cytokine diffusion. Not always available in all centers. There are few centers which are available, but yes, it is showing promising results. Next is an injection therapy. You have to be extremely careful while giving a steroid injection plantar fascia. You have to be aware of fat pad atrophy. Sometimes you see a plantar fascia rupture and sometimes osteomyelitis of calcaneal bone if you've injected in an osteoporotic bone where the needle has penetrated the calcaneal tuberosity. You can also try some PRP therapy. How will you inject? It's very important that you inject at a proper location. If you're doing it in an OPD practice, this is how it is. You need a long 25 gauge needle, which is like an inch and a half long. You can take around 5 ml of steroids and local anesthetic. You have to confirm the painful site, draw a vertical line along the posterior margin of tibia and come down right up to where the pain is. Draw this line, draw a second horizontal line along the inferior margin of the calcaneum. At a point where this intersects is your point of injection. So you need to, I enter medially, and I'll tell you why I do it. So enter medially, cross the midline, aspirate and inject as you withdraw. So you can infiltrate on the plantar fascia. Yes, you have to be careful of not spilling it into the fat pad, which is inferior to the plantar fascia. Why I enter medially is because then I can go supra plantar fascia and not inferior. infra plantar fascia. Second point is plantar fascia being extremely thick are extremely painful to kind of penetrate with your needle. So patient is extremely painful when you do an infracalcaneal or through a plantar fascia injections. So again, draw a line vertical through the posterior margin of tibia, inferior border of calcaneum, intersection, cross the midline, aspirate and inject. So by this, you will kind of more often than not hit the point where you need to inject the drug material. Lastly, when rarely indicated cases like one or two in a year, maybe in my hands, if there is a plantar nerve compression, you need to do a plantar fascia release. You can do it open like you do a tarsal tunnel release or a Schindler's release. Or nowadays we do it an endoscopic plantar fascia release, how you do a carpal tunnel endoscopic release. But yes, in our hands, the indication of surgery for plantar fascia is extremely rare, like less than 1% of our cases. Next, very common case of heel pain is a plantar nerve impingement. Very often missed, the pain over here is felt more medial than plantar at the origin of abductor hallucis, which we've seen in the anatomy. The nerve that is compressed is the nerve to abductor digiti minimi, which is the first branch of lateral plantar nerve. These are branches from the posterior tibial nerve. So it comes medially, crosses, as you've seen in the picture, crosses plantarwards and goes laterally. These patients are amenable for surgical releases and they do really well. Another common case that we have heel pain, especially in our cities, that especially with the marathon culture increasing, is calcaneal stress fracture. The differential point is heel pain, which gets worse with activity and better with rest, which is mild on the first step. And as you increase weight bearing, the pain increases. So the treatment is very simple. You need to activity modification and rest. So to summarize the differentials for infracalcaneal heel pain, how would you differentiate the pointers? Plantar fasciitis, that's early morning pain, more on the first steps, better as they walk. As contrary to calcaneal stress fracture, which is no pain on the first few steps, pain increases as the activity rises and there is a sudden increase in activity like marathon running training or something. The third differential is heel fat pad atrophy. There the pain is on every step because the fat pad is never going to generate or regenerate. Pain on walking, every step is similar. There would be an history of local steroid injections. Next, a plantar nerve impingement. As we've discussed, there might be tingling or paresthesia or tinnitus signs which may be positive. And lastly, certain inflammatory arthropathies which may have morning stiffness, other joint complaints. So infracalcaneal, these 5 points are the most common reasons where you will hit 99.9% of your infracalcaneal heel pain patients. Next, coming to a next subgroup, which is less often found in our country, but extremely more satisfying to treat, is a retrocalcaneal heel pain, where the pain is behind the heel. That conditions that are encountered over here are Hägglund syndrome, tendoacyles insertional tendinosis, and retrocalcaneal bursitis. These three are all intermingled, and there is a huge overlap between all these three symptoms. So, brief anatomy, Achilles tendon is the largest tendon. It is of three muscles, two gastroheads and a soleus, and hence it's also called the triceps surae. It is type 1 collagen alpha helix, which gives it the strength and resilience. In fact, we humans, it is one of the hallmark of we being humans because we are bipedal because of these Achilles tendon. We can walk on our two legs. It doesn't have a tenosynovium. It has a paratenon, which gets its blood supply. And these insertional fibers from the calcaneum also continue as the plantar fascia, and hence Achilles tightness can also predispose you to plantar fasciitis. So to differentiate between the terminology, it was previously labeled as tendinitis, which is only now called in acute phase where there is inflammatory changes at the tendon or the paratenon level. More often what we come across is tendinosis, which is a degenerative process where there is reactive tendinopathy, which kind of fails to heal, that is tendon disrepair, and ends up with a degenerative tendinopathy. So reactive tendinopathy progressing to degenerative tendinopathy, and hence it is called Achilles tendinosis. And there are two types of tendinosis. One is non-insertional, which is more common to see ruptures, and insertional, which we see more often in degenerative Achilles heel pains or infracalcaneal heel pains. So the incidence of this condition is unclear. It is reported as most common form of Achilles tendinopathy in athletes, but it's also seen in older, less athletic, overweight individuals, and especially in our country in diabetics. So structurally, it's an osteotendinous junction at the Achilles, where there is tendon, fibrocartilage, and the body of the calcaneum. So fibrocartilage is more like an enthesis where there is a sesamoid which protects the tendon from decompression while during dorsiflexion, and the periosteum which protects the superior tuberosity of calcaneum. So histopathologically, there are all degenerative tendinosis changes where there is mucoid degeneration, disruption of collagen, necrosis, small hemorrhage, calcification, increased enzymatic activity, which all show that there is more than inflammation, there is degeneration in this pathology. What is the etiopathology of this condition? It's primarily the overuse. So you have a tight Achilles tendon, as I explained, you know, the tight sleeve which pulls, and this is where it kind of troubles. So hyperpronation and foot deformity can cause, add to that the obesity of the patient, all predisposed to degeneration, attrition, mechanical abrasion at the bone tendon interface, and causing chemical irritation. So the chronic inflammatory response brings about a spur formation and calcification due to repeated traction force. So these heel spurs which are behind are pathologic, unlike the infracalcaneal heel spurs which are physiologic. This tendon degeneration heel spurs can be treated extremely well. So what is a Hägglund syndrome? It's a triad of insertional tendinosis, Achilles tendinosis, retrocalcaneal bursitis, which is inflammation in front of the tendon, that is retrocalcaneum, and the Hägglund's deformity, which is the posterior superior calcaneal exostosis, the bump of the calcaneum. All three put together form the Hägglund syndrome. So what does the patient come with? We'll have focal tenderness and bump at the bone tendon junction. Again, the patient will complain first of pain while getting up from bed, better as he walks, and again in the evening due to fatigue, there might be more pain. On examination, there would be tenderness locally, thickening at the bone tendon junction, and a tight gastrocnemius. On imaging, you will find x-rays which will confirm the enthesophyte or osteophyte. Sonography, our power Doppler will show area of neovascularization. MRI will confirm the diagnosis and identify the extent of involvement of degeneration of tendon, which is very important if you're planning a surgical procedure. You need to debride the degenerative tendon entirely in toto and repair it back to the footprint. It's like a rotator cuff tear which is degenerate. So how do you treat insertional tendinosis? Again, 8 out of the 10 patients do well with stretching. You need to go eccentric loading program for Achilles. You need to go up to neutral. You can try soft heel, open counter shoes, heel raise to avoid irritation of this bump onto your shoe counter. Stretching needs to be followed by strengthening. How do you do these exercises? The most effective treatment for tendinopathy is eccentric stretching program. Alfredson's protocol has 15 repetitions of 3 sets twice a day for 12 weeks. You start with the position on the edge of the step with the ankle in neutral and knee slightly flexed. That's the first position. Second position is to dorsiflex or drop your heels down with your knee slightly flexed. Finishing position is to finishing position is ankle dorsiflexion with knee extended. So you start ankle neutral, knee flexed, ankle dropped or ankle dorsiflexed, heel dropped with knee flexed, and finish with an extended knee. By this, you stretch your gastroc and soleus and load it eccentrically with your body weight. You need to do these 15 repetitions 3 times twice a day for 12 weeks. It is supposed to be really good and it shows good results at 3 weeks. Second line of treatment is extracorporeal shockwave therapy, like as you see it over here. You can try like 3 times spaced over 1 week apart, 2000 pulses with a pressure of 2.5 bars pressure and frequency of 8 pulse per second. Area of maxillary tenderness and circumferential. This also has shown like good results at around 3 months period in randomized controlled trial. Lastly, or second last, you can try an injection, but you have to be extremely careful while doing an injection in and around the Achilles where you can cause an iatrogenic rupture. So corticosteroids, avoid as far as possible. If you are giving, give it only in the retrocalcaneal bursa. Try and give image guided like SIAM or something, but you can also give, like as we will show it right now. If you're going intratendinous, you can try the PRP and other biologics which are used or which are shown to be useful. Again, over here, you take a 25 gauge needle. Retrocalcaneal bursa can accommodate more fluid or more injections. Like you can take 10 ml of your medicine that you are giving. You need to note your anatomy extremely well. Draw your Achilles tendon, like draw a mark, palpate the Achilles tendon mark the tender point where there is maximum tenderness. I do it in prone position with my knee bent as shown in the picture. While injecting, I direct my needle anteriorly, which is away from my tendon, and go in my retrocalcaneal bursa. I have no problems if it goes more anteriorly into the subtalar joint or in the hind foot of the ankle, but I try and avoid going in and around the Achilles tendon, which in a degenerate tendon in a diabetic is more amenable to ruptures. So going intratendinous, try doing or avoid the corticosteroids and try doing the biologics like the PRPs. So after the injection, the last option is surgery, where you need to make sure that you address the entire pathology, where you've debrided the tendon and taken the bump and repaired the tendon back or repaired the normal tendon back to the footprint. So you can take any incision as long as your soft tissue handling is neat and not messy. You can take midline paramedian or you can also take an L approach. Some people also take the Cincinnati approach, which has shown good results in pediatric patients. If there is tendon is not involved and is only the Haglund deformity and bursa, you can try an endoscopic calcaneoplasty where only the bump is removed. And where the tendon is involved in more than 50% of the tendon, you need a tendon transfer where in more often than not, the FHL tendon is used, that the flexor hallucis longus tendon. So Haglund's decompression, where all the three components of Haglund syndrome, the Achilles tendon, the bursa and the bump all need to be addressed. The Achilles tendon along with the enthesophytes and the tendinosis needs to be debrided. Retrocalcaneal bursa needs to be excised and the bump needs to be knocked out. This is a pictorial form of our L-shaped approach where we've removed the tendon, debrided it and refixed it with a suture anchor. So with this video, what we'll be showing is how we do it in without anchors, which you can do it very easily in your routine OPD. This is one of those videos that we've made for instructional course lecture for Foot and Ankle Society. I do it in a lateral position with patient turned outwards. This is the position where, the final position where we see. I have taken a midline approach over here. I draw my anatomy, mark my tendon, so that in case if my tendon is too tight and I'm not able to kind of bring it back, I can go approximately and do a fractional release of my Achilles tendon. So take a midline approach. Make sure, so after exsanguinate, take a midline approach and make sure that you go right up to the tendon without elevating the flaps in multiple layers. So you need to elevate the flap in a single layer so that you can kind of get up to the tendon and there is no soft tissue breakdown after the surgery. Elevate on both the sides of the tendon and come right up to the footprint. Make sure that you elevate in a single flap. And if you're working more on the left side, then don't unnecessarily retract on the opposite side. Let it fall down. Make sure that you kind of keep on irrigating the flaps so that there is not much of soft tissue damage. To debride the tendon, I make a window like an L shape. So this is my vertical limb and I'll follow it up with a lateral limb. So with this, I have kind of elevated the footprint, elevated the tendon from the footprint. This also exposes all the degenerative tendon that is there. We need to do this on both the sides. It's like a open book technique, like open the window where you open both the flaps of the tendon now and debrided all the degenerative yellowish looking tendon. So this is the degenerative tendon. It's quite eminent, quite visible, that degeneration as compared to the normal tendon. Now what I'm prodding is at the retrocalcaneal bursa. That is one of the component of pain riser. You need to debride that too. Then come to the Haglund's bump. So before complete degenerative tendon excision, I try and take the bump out. It improves the visualization of the tendon and the retrocalcaneal area. Once you've taken the bump out, make sure that you do a liberal bumpectomy because we don't want this bump to again re-irritate our repaired tendon. This is the entire bump that has come out. Make sure that the edges of these osteotomy are smooth and not irritating. Now this helps you to kind of debride the remaining tendon part also better. So this is the degenerate tendon which is being excised. Make sure that you do it thoroughly. Liberal excision of the back tendon. There's no point in repairing a back tendon to your good bone because that's again going to cause pain to the patient. So you've removed the retrocalcaneal bursa furthermore. Made sure that our calcaneal bumpectomy is adequate. As described, always put some fluid on the edges of your skin margin so that they don't dry and cause necrosis. I'm confirming that my excision is adequate. I'm happy with my excision. If you remember the first picture, it had a lot of bones. So over here, what we are trying to show you is a transosseous repair without anchors. The first picture that I'd shown you, a case that I'd shown you was with anchors. So here I've made bone tunnels. It's like a transosseous repair of rotator cuff. I'm taking sutures through the tendon and I'm repairing my vertical defect that I had made, the window that I had opened. I'm closing it up. It's a modified Krakow stitch. Once I'm through, I'm trying to see if my repair is coming down to the footprint. If it doesn't come, you can release proximally, fractional release of the tendon. And I'm pulling it down through the heel pad, making a small nick to make sure that I can tie my sutures down onto the heel. So you pull through both the limbs of the sutures. Make sure that there are no soft tissue entanglement and you've got a good bone to tendon approximation while you're tying the sutures. So this kind of makes you heal the tendon back onto the footprint. So transosseous sutures is easily possible without anchors. So you don't need expensive anchors to kind of repair the Hagelund's bump. And if you close the sutures, close the skin sutures. So that was one demonstration of a normal classic Hagelund's deformity where the tendon is also involved. If the tendon is normal, only the bursa and the bump is troublesome. You can do an endoscopic calcaneoplasty with bursectomy. This is a pictorial form. And this is the video of the, this is the video of the calcaneoplasty where if you see, so it's an arthroscopic, like how you do a subacromial decompression, something like that. So we're going to do the right side, left side was operated elsewhere. Right side, the tendon is looking good, but the bump is too big. Again, do a lateral position and do a posterior hindfoot arthroscopy. Portals are para-Achilles. And this is how your retrocalcaneal bursoscopy looks. You go in further and try and debride all this bursa. So Achilles tendon repair has predominantly evolved from shoulder rotator cuff. So this is the bursectomy. If you see the red fluid inflamed part on the bottom of your screen, this is the retrocalcaneal bursa, how it looks. So you can biopsy it, send it for further histopath or culture. And then once you've done an entire bursectomy, you can go in further and expose the Achilles tendon because you also need to take the bump out. So this is the calcaneum that has come after taking the bursa. I'm trying to burr out the calcaneum. In your initial cases, you might have to take help of the CM to make sure that it's adequate. But as your growth curve improves, learning curve improves, you can kind of, you are pretty sure of your debridement. So this is the calcaneum. On the right is the Achilles tendon. Go in further and make sure that especially the edges are clean and not sharp. But more often than not, if you've used a burr, the edges will not be that sharp. Go on and debride the calcaneum. So use a small joint burr, the calcaneal bumpectomy. This is how it's seen. Use both the portals. So this is the raw calcaneum that has been debrided, and that is the calcaneum with the periosteum. We are kind of smoothing the edges over there. And that is the Achilles tendon, which is now freed of the bump, which was irritating. So intraop, take a C-arm shoot to begin with. I was not happy with that small spur which was there. So I went in again and you kind of do it. So initial cases, do not hesitate to do or may take care of or take help of the C-arm to make sure that the calcaneal bumpectomy and debridement is adequate. So now I am happy with that spur also being excised. That was endoscopic calcaneoplasty. Rarely in a degenerate cases where the degeneration is large or the gap between the tendon and the bone is too much, you need to do an FHL transfer. FHL transfer can be done open, mini open or endoscopic as we're showing over here. Again, the same arthroscopy portals, but you need to, this is the FHL which is seen from the back of the ankle. You need to harvest the FHL from the hind foot and go on and transfer it to your calcaneal tuberosity. This is how it goes. And patient is able to do well. So this is again what initially was thought, that you know, Achilles brings down the mighty warriors and the surgeons. But nowadays with minimally invasive surgeries like these endoscopic and MIS surgeries, you can get out of Achilles repairs extremely well. Post-op management, again, compression dressing, non-weight bearing for 2 weeks with a slab. You end up with suture removal and then put them in a long boot with three wedges. Gradually weight bearing from 3 week onwards and start ankle range of movements. You start initially with only with plantar flexion and avoid the dorsiflexion. From 6 weeks, the patient starts weight bearing in a protective boot or a shoe. And 12 weeks onwards, strengthening and sport specific training is taken up. So just to summarize, heel pain, you need to kind of classify them into infracalcaneum and retrocalcaneum. Infracalcaneal pain, again, commonly plantar fasciitis and other causes, do not forget, are heel pad pad atrophy, stress fractures, nerve impingements, and inflammatory arthropathies. While retrocalcaneal heel pain has Hägglund syndrome, Achilles insertional tendinosis, and retrocalcaneal bursitis. So if you kind of differentiate these two categories, it will be very easy for you to kind of treat your heel pain patients in your regular OPD. Thank you very much. Thank you, Neeraj. Thank you, Ortho TV.
Thank you, Abhishek. That was a very comprehensive cover of heel pain. Such a small topic which we just take casually sometimes and tell ke garam pani se sek karo and soft footwear pehno. So I want to ask you a few queries.
Yes.
So how frequently, see, I have nowadays started avoiding giving injections because most of the times I am seeing that steroid injections, especially in plantar fasciitis, have only temporary relief or sometimes no relief without a set of stretching exercises. So is it true in your practice also?
Yes, it is true. So what role does corticosteroid injection have in plantar fascia is, honestly, it gives you a window period where you will have a pain-free period till the drug is acting. The drug cannot act forever. The drug cannot reverse the degeneration. The drug only takes care of the inflammatory component which is present at that local site. Rather than popping too many pills, you can inject and tell the patient that the treatment is going to be stretching. Injection is only going to give you temporary relief, whether 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 2 months, depends on the local action and the amount of degeneration or inflammation that is present. And stretching is the crux. So treatment is stretching only, stretching, stretching and stretching. If someone has a wedding in the family, I would inject that patient and tell them that, you know, it will give you a free period where even if you don't get time to stretch, this will still pull you out. But if you want to come out of it, you need stretching.
And what do you exactly give? Do you give a methylprednisolone or do you give triamcinolone?
I give a triamcinolone, sir, along with a mixture of bupivacaine and lignocaine. So 1 ml local lignocaine, 2 ml bupivacaine, which is a longer acting, and 2 cc of triamcinolone, which is 80 mg.
How often do you use sonography for giving the injection?
More often than not, sonography guided, I will try and explain that it has more precision, local things and all. But again, it comes at a cost. And some patients who have outstation and can't get your muscle, can't get your MSK guided, MSK trained sonologist, then I will tell them that yes, we can do it in the OPD also. But yes, the hit and chance misses are more if you do it blindly or anatomically rather than sonographically.
Okay, so do you see post-injection pain? Means do you tell that the patient will have 2-3 days pain? Most of my patients have.
Yes, they will. So first a day or two, because it's like a very tight space and you've injected more material or more volume in that space, there might be exacerbation of pain for the first 2 days. But by that time, the drug diffuses and things settle down in a day or two, sir. Yes. So I would counsel them that post-injection, they might have to ice it, take an anti-inflammatory for a couple of days, and things will start showing results at the end of 1 week, 2 weeks or more sometimes.
And you also showed a procedure where you were injecting in the tendo-Achilles area, insertional and retrocalcaneal area. I find it that basically the complication rate is much higher. Means there is a chance of a rupture.
So I will inject Achilles very rarely. I will inject provided only the Achilles tendon is not showing too much of degeneration and the bursa is inflamed. If there is an Achilles tendon that is degenerate, I will avoid injections. And if I have to inject, then I might inject a more like a PRP rather than a corticosteroid, because corticosteroids cause ruptures left, right and center, especially in a diabetic, where it just kind of takes the degeneration level furthermore. In fact, there are certain studies that tell that by taking the pain away, you kind of promote the patient to walk a bit more briskly. And that is actually what causes the rupture, not entirely the degeneration itself. But sometimes, because degeneration can't happen by injecting within a week or two, it will have a process. But that pain that you take away causes a forceful contraction in a weakened tendon, and that causes the rupture. So you have to tell the patient after injection that you will have to avoid vigorous activities and avoid that sudden push off activities also.
And do you give heel raise, any role of heel raise in tendinopathies?
For more, the role of heel raise is mechanical, where by raising the heel, you reduce the irritation of the bump onto the tendon. So what it does is it kind of takes the foot slightly in a downward position so that this bump, posterior bump, doesn't irritate the tendon that is coming behind. So it does have a role in reducing the irritation of the tendon and bringing the bursa down.
And as you said in your presentation, so how do we explain that many times patient comes with a spur? So is the spur the cause of pain, or the pain is the cause, or the fasciitis is the cause of spur?
As I said, infracalcaneal, the spur is physiologic. The spur is not at the position of plantar fascia. The spur actually, if you do anatomical dissections, it is more laterally at the origin of flexor digitorum brevis. It is not at plantar fascia. In a two-dimensional X-ray, you will see the spur, but it is not the cause of pain. So spur and plantar fascia are two independent things. So how I explain the patient, because they come to me after meeting a lot of doctors and physios where they have been told that this is the cause of pain, I always try to say in presentation that if you have a nail or a thorn in your heel, every step should be painful. And if you assume that this spur is the thorn in your heel, you don't have pain at every step. You will have pain to begin with, then the pain goes away and it comes back in the evening. When it goes away, it's not withdrawn. It is still there. And if it was the cause of pain, it should have been painful every time and not just at certain times of the day. So this kind of explains the patient that yes, it is not the cause of pain. Otherwise, if you are treating it and they keep on seeing these spurs, they will always feel that you've not done anything to them because the spur has not been taken out.
So spur can be considered just as an incidental finding in plantar fasciitis?
Most often.
Okay. And even in normal patients, you said that some percentage of population will have the calcaneal spur.
I'm very sure anyone above 40, 15 to 20% patient will have the spur.
Okay. And about this surgery, which you said about the transosseous thing. So right. When you do a transosseous, you make a hole and the stitch and the knots are basically at the calcaneum. They stay at the calcaneum or you put a button?
No. You make sure that you flush it down onto the calcaneum. So that button is to cause a lot of complications. So if you put it, like if you blunt dissected and kind of stitched it on the bridge of the calcaneum, it will not cause you any trouble because the skin heals over itself.
So issue is that sometimes we are drilling it and sometimes we don't drill it accurately, we drill it again. So there are two holes formed in the calcaneum. So how does the knot stay over the holes?
So you need to drill it carefully. So what tip I would like to give is make sure that once you've drilled one hole, keep something in it like a needle or a K wire in it and you drill a parallel hole to it. So in the video, I made the nick after my sutures were passed. Actually, I make a nick before my sutures are passed with my K wires in it so that my sutures don't get cut. So that way it's like how you have to pass two screws in the medial malleolus. You put one screw and make sure that you keep it over there or put a drill over there and make a drill, another drill, so that you're parallel to that drill. By keeping that parallel orientation, you'll have a bridge on the infracalcaneal side and your knots will be on that bony bridge and the knots will not coalesce together.
Okay. That's a very good tip. What about have you ever faced a situation where you went in thinking that you'll be able to repair it and then you had to change it to FHL transfer?
Yes, very often, and more often than not nowadays, I always tell the patient that if I'm going to struggle where I'm not getting the tendon down, I will not hesitate to put the FHL into the calcaneum. So I will preoperatively counsel because the degeneration is unexplainable. Like you have to do a visual degeneration and sometimes the calf is so tight that you just can't get it down.
Okay. So one more thing which I learned today is that when we are doing a Hagelin's deformity, it is compulsory to take the tendon out from the insertion. Correct. Many people used to not do it earlier. You have to actually remove the tendon from the insertion. Only then you'll be able to do the full justice to the surgery.
Correct. Because the pathology is triphasal. Like, you know, you have the bump, you have the tendon and you have the bursa. So if you take the bump and the bursa and you keep a degenerate tendon, that tendon will always remain to be painful. So you have to address all three. And I think the reason was that we all are a little apprehensive to touch the Achilles, thinking that it will not heal. But if you bring a raw surface like a good vascular calcaneum and reattach the tendon back onto the footprint, like you've seen, like it will heal. It will osteointegrate in around good 6 weeks' time.
And what is the suture material which you used? Fiber wire?
I use the Ultra Braid, which is the Smith & Nephew, something similar to the fiber wire. I just believe that the fiber wire, rather the Ultra Braid, has a better knotting. So the knots are little low profile as compared to the fiber wire. Yes, I do not use the orthopod. If I don't have these Ultra Braids, I will not hesitate to put a good strong Vicryl OS also. Like I have no problem even to use a Mersilk, because not an Ethibond, but Ethibond causes a lot of foreign body reaction on the contrary. So I use an Ultra Braid.
Ultra Braid, okay. And I think this is it. You have answered most of the queries. We thank you very much for sparing your precious time. And we also thank GSK Consumer for giving us an unrestricted educational grant to conduct these original webinars. Thank you very much and good night. Oh, shit. Thank you very much and good night to everyone.